first few practical things. Please follow the green and white signs if you want to go out quickly. On both sides you can leave the building. We have some water problems, but hopefully not that bad that we have to leave. If you want to go to the toilets are on the ground floor, and if these are occupied, you can find at the same spot above the toilets on the first floor and the second floor.
I'm going to use the microphone just selectively. Who of you owns it? That's great. Me too. Who of you owns it and uses a password manager? Who of you uses cold stores? Pretty good. I will have to ask a question later, people. Thanks, it gives me an idea of the audience. Every meetup that we organize, we start with a small,
I can hear it very bad, so I start using it.
I have to use the microphone. Is that better?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah? Okay. Every meetup that we organize together with A-Lab, we have a short introduction about what cryptocurrency is. I think the people that are gathered here don't need that right away, so I keep this short as possible. Who doesn't know what a Bitcoin is? Okay. All right. If you're a first timer here, we have a leaflet, and the boss will give that to you. You can study more after the presentation. Bitcoin is a cryptocurrency, and we have three definitions for that. We have a technical definition that says that there is a peer-to-peer network on the internet where people keep a central ledger, a central source of truth that they keep in sync with each other. And every node, every computer that is in the network judges independently whether transactions that are promoted through the network are valid or not. So they can't judge whether they are criminal transactions or big transactions. They can only judge whether it's a valid transaction or not, and they do that independently. So that's the technical definition of a Bitcoin, a central single source of truth worldwide and available immediately. If we go to the business definition, then we can transact that Bitcoin or any units of account of that cryptocurrency from A to B. So we could say it goes from one person to another, or it goes from a person to a machine, or from a machine to a machine. And we can trust that. And that's the third aspect of Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. That's the fact that you can rely on the settlement of those transactions. And what happens is that we don't need any third party involved to settle that transaction. We use a consensus mechanism. And that's new. And if you summarize that, so the network, the transactions, and the legal settlement, you get a totally new, without the need of a third party, you get a totally new ecosystem that can store and transmit value and money. What's the difference between money and value? We discovered, or they discovered back in 2010, that you can also transmit and store all kinds of value, not only Bitcoin, but you can also store any link to other value in cryptocurrencies. I see you nodding all the time, so is that more or less understandable?
It's not that I know nothing about it.
Okay, keep nodding if I'm in the right direction, please.
Sure.
Thank you. So, in this ecosystem, we need a lot of security, because if you want to transmit value, there's somebody that encrypts the value so that you can timestamp it, the transmission, so that you can verify it later. Because it's in this big open ledger, freely accessible, uncensorable, immutable, etc., etc. So if we want to check that, we need security to be able to trust it. I make one step back, because people think that you can put data on the blockchain. You hear that a lot. We throw that on the blockchain. I have a contract or whatever, and oh yes, we throw it on the blockchain. But what do they actually throw on the blockchain? That's only the proof of the data. So you have this big chunk of data, you make a proof of that, and that's what you actually put on the blockchain. And then again, you encrypt it, you timestamp it, so that you can verify that later. But what you can actually verify is not the data itself. It's only the proof of the data, and that's called a hash. Today, we are talking about key management. This one. And so I won't go into further detail of the blockchain or Bitcoin or whatever, because we want to talk a lot about how to manage the keys. And today we have two other speakers. That's David Goller of Cryptsys, and he's going to talk about two and three factor on the password managers. Exactly, yeah. And Aaron Overstein is going to talk about cold storage. What we do not, this is what we're not going to do then. And especially this one is interesting, because we need wallets to manage our keys. So, but we are not going into too deep discussion about the software itself. We want to look at the data in the wallet. Because a wallet is not something that contains coins or whatever. It's just a keychain. And I don't see too many people talking now. So is that principle clear to you? Alright? See if you know. So it doesn't contain the real coins. The coins are on the blockchain. And you have the keys in your wallet. So you can, let's say, prove your ownership of those coins on the blockchain. Okay? So still with me? You still with me? Yeah? Okay, good. This one is interesting as well. No biometry. Because in authentication, which is the subject of tonight, authentication of your private keys, your identity, it's also always about something you have, something you know, or something you are. And biometry is something that can prove what you are. But we skip that today. So we will focus on what you have and what you know for the key management here. There are a lot of security issues. This is what we're going to do. This is the how. So if you're still wondering, how should I manage my keys, this is it. And we're about done with it now. You know, you can read this and work through. And you might be more interested in this, in the latter part of the list, than of this part. But I'm more interested in the upper sentences. Take some time to read through them. So these are very practical tips. But if you're not learning step by step,
in a routing way, then it will not land. You know, it can give you a tip, do this or do that. But if it hasn't found a base, then it won't work. And it will introduce more problems if you would execute it without knowing what you do. So we're going to look at which kind of procedures you can take, steps you can take to get there. If we have value in general, let's say we have value to secure, and it's not just the security of the Bitcoin, but also of the whole network, of your own computer. Security in general, it's an enormous area to work in.
This big.
So if you want to have ease of use in this area, and you want to, have easy access to things that should be safe, you can say, my password is admin. That's easy, but it's not so safe. Right? And what's really at stake is your identity, because every cryptocurrency public key is a representation of you. It's your digital me. So you control that with a key, but a public key is your digital me. It's very important to realize that, because you have to keep that safe. If you don't keep it safe, anybody can steal your identity and everything that goes along with that. So, but I think you're here because you want to know more about how to manage those keys. So in the past, we had no digital keys, we had no digital virtual identities. We only had anonymity and privacy, and we could use them at will. And today we have 500 companies or even more that contain data of your me, so to say. So they contain they have your personal data, and they combine that, and they might even know more about you than you yourself. And we want to get rid of that. We want to have a world where we have more sovereignty about our own me. We want to have keys that only we control. So that's what it's all about too. So you have crypto value, but it's also contracts, it involves personal data, and we all want to secure that. And the funny thing is that techniques are more or less the same. So we can use the overlap between identity management and blockchain here. Short recap. So we need a key, a timestamp, and we can later verify it if it's on the blockchain. But we need the original data to do that. The wallet, it's not data-wise, it's a keychain. It has nothing to do with storing coins. So a Bitcoin, for example, it's an unspent transaction actually. If you don't know what it is, just look it up later, Google it. We look at decentralized open source, etc. So we really want to touch the innovation. So we're not looking at private blockchains, we're looking at public blockchains. And you're exposed to the open. We want to be sure that we manage our keys there in that hostile environment. So what Antonopoulos says about this, how many of you use a web wallet? Like for example, who stores his or her coins at an exchange? Okay. Who uses a wallet service like Coinbase to store coins? So that's the first to do that. We should stop right away. What we should do is we should go in,
do the stuff they have to do and get out of there as soon as possible. It's like the war rhetoric of Bush Senior. Get in there, do the job you have to do, and get out of there as soon as possible. That's the idea. And you get, for example, if you want to exchange from one cryptocurrency to another, you go to the exchange, do the exchange, and take the coins out again. This is another quote. It's my quote. Why you have to carefully manage your keys and why you won't. And I use the work of I'm happy to use the work of Pamela Morgan with this, because we have to learn how to adapt, how to learn, how to stay alive in this hostile environment with all these possible attacks, people that try to steal your bitcoins or your cryptocurrencies in general, and that we can be more confident, more at ease, more less blood rushing through your brains if you think you've lost some of your coins, and then later on you happily you see that they are not lost, and it was just a mistake of the interface. So a few people laughing at that story, because I've had quite a few times that I think they were all, oh my god, where are they? But if you learn more, you know what the critical points are. So Pamela Morgan has a few quotes. She's in the business for 5 years already. I provide many links to her work in the sheets, and you get the sheets later. You can download them from the Commissioner Society meetup site. So you can read more there. But she says, she starts off with this. This one's very recognizable for me too. Anyone wants to react on them? More or less paralyzed if you don't know the steps to take to learn more about key management. The real thing is, and that's the takeaway that I want to give you, is there's the link to the article. You have to build up a routine. You have to build up a routine of learning more about all the aspects, the different aspects of key management. Whether it is strong passwords, two-factor authentication, secret sharing schemes, multi-signatures, cold stores, etc. You have to force yourself to study them regularly, and that using the new knowledge is like strapping a seatbelt. When you step in your car, you don't even think about it, it's just strapping a seatbelt. What does a crypto key look like? They're ugly bastards. It's just like strong passwords, and a strong password I will go into detail more next week. An example is over there. It's like a string with characters, string with symbols, digits, pretty unrecognizable. We have seats, and seats are 12 words, English or any other language. And hopefully you didn't invent them yourself, but you use a seat generator. There are hex strings as well, hexadecimal strings, you see them over here. This is the wallet from bit address to all. This is how they look like. And you have QR codes as a representation of the hexadecimal strings. So they're not different, they're the same. This is can anybody say, is there any redundant information on this green one? Could anyone recognize redundant information on this wallet? Paperwork. It's a paperwork. No?
I think the bus phrase is redundant.
Sorry, I can't
hear you.
I would say that the bus phrase is especially information that's redundant.
Bus phrase.
He's the big one that's all about.
Well, what I thought of was the public key. You don't need a
public key. Yeah.
Because you can generate a public key from the private key. Thanks anyway. I didn't see it. I didn't recognize the password, so that's all. If it's there, it's also redundant. It's not the password itself, it's an explanation.
But still, why is your password required for something that simply saves privacy?
It's not. It's not. It's not required in this case. Because we have a private key over here. So that could generate the public key as well. It's hard to do, but it could. Strong passwords. Maybe not everybody can read this cartoon fully, but passwords are harsh and things to grasp. If you try to invent passwords yourself, they might be less secure than the ones that are generated. And this cartoon does it in a funny way. You can read it later. The rule of thumb for strong passwords are at least 20 characters, 24, even better. And then use digits, use characters, and use symbols in a totally random way. That's a good password. We mentioned seats before too. A seat is something that generates a master key. And the Bitcoin improvement protocol that did that is Bitcoin improvement. Protocol 39. And what it actually does is it grows a seat to a master key, and from the master key you can make a lot of extra string of keys, but they are all connected to the master key. So when you have the master key, when you have a seat, you can always restore what you do. That's why we are very much interested in securing seats.
Sorry, question, just to be sure, master key is the same as the private key? I can't hear because this
master key is the same as the private key.
The master key is, it's a typical form of a private key. It's a hierarchical deterministic key. You can make offsprings of that key. It goes a bit further than the content of my presentation, but if you will look up power or then you see keys, you will find more information. What we are specifically interested in is the bold-faced ways of storing our private keys. Brain wallets, paper wallets, and hardware wallets. As we said before, Erwin is going to take it from there, from console hardware. And this one is a very typical one as well, because we have software on the web that you might call that a hot wallet. But if the keys are stored well in the cold store, and it only uses, only offers you the functionality to access those cold stores, then it's, well, it's still a cold store, but it's intermediate. I won't go into multi-signature today, but it's a way to, with more people, I'm looking for the English word, so it can take a long time. They can together decide whether a certain amount of cryptocurrency should be the first word.
Authorized.
Sorry?
Authorized.
Authorized, that's the word. Thank you. with a functional approach to how to manage keys, why should we manage keys? What's the reason? There must be some kind of a life cycle of a key. First, we create them, of course. Why, of course? Because if you use a wallet and you want to receive some value, you create a key and you want to control that. That's the first step. You can also use a paper wallet to do that. The second step is you back up your identities right away. Because if you don't, and something happens to your software, then your value is lost. Your store is not accessible anymore. The next step is, I think not many people realize that until they nearly lose all their cryptocurrencies, is that if you have firmware on your cold source, for example, and you have to reinstall that, you have to use the same keys, the seeds, to be able to run the cold store again. And if you don't know the seeds, you're in big trouble again. So you use the keys to edit the world software as well. And this is the most common use of keys. You transmit value. But you can use those same keys to sign off digital representation of anything. So you can sign a document, you can sign a Bitcoin, you can sign a hash pointer, you can sign off on everything. And you can also use those keys to encrypt. For example, does anybody use PGP? PGP? Many? But it's a pretty good privacy, and it's if you control the key of that, you can use the public key as a virtual identity. And the good thing about that is that you can sign data, and for example, emails, and somebody else with the ownership of your public key can read the message. And this is, I think, a very important one. Because if you're not able to think anymore in a clever way, or you die, unfortunately, somebody needs to get access to your keys. And I think we should call that estate planning, and it's very important. Pamela Morgan has a few articles, and there are links in my sheets, about this issue. And she has a very good step-by-step to make your own estate planning with private keys. What you shouldn't do is this. Read through it later. With brain wallet solo, you don't have to photograph them, you can get them made for you.
Yeah, if you like, you may.
Brain wallet solo, I mean, with this sentence, I mean that if you keep in mind a certain key that you use to encrypt the data, and you are not able to communicate it anymore for various reasons, then the crypto value is lost. So we like managed brain wallets. And a managed brain wallet means that you, with your beloved ones, you sit together and you think of something that happened in the past which you all know of. For example, you had a dog that jumped in a pool once and got out with a puppet that looked like Elvis, for example. So you all sit, strange thing happening. So you write down, for example, dog, pool, 1999, for example. But that reminds everybody of that group, of some other words that we never communicate again. But that's the key that we use to encrypt the data. So if one of the group key passes away, then the other ones still remember the dog jumping in the pool and know them, the words that they use to get the data. And it's a managed brain model, I'd say. I'm not 100% sure about what you should not do. I think follow the step by step is pretty awesome. So if you write down step by steps, your own step by step, and you make mistakes with that, and you follow it later, then you might lose your value. Or you use the step by step of somebody else and you don't really understand what's happening, they might lure you into a way of transmitting your value to somebody else. And I'm not 100% sure about using a mobile phone as a security factor, but maybe Dave can say something more about that.
Yeah, right now or
Later. In 5 minutes more or less.
Okay.
So what are the do's of cryptocurrency? We already listed them before. We have to choose a wallet. We didn't mention it. We didn't show any option of wallets, but there's plenty of options of wallets. We have to choose one, but the most important thing is we create backup and use our own keys. We don't want to manage single keys ourselves because we will lose value in them. Here we go to manage brain wallets again. So read through it, Google it, and read the articles of Penla, and it will help you out. Then specifically paper wallets. A paper wallet is something you print on a paper sheet and you put that away. And you have to be careful with that as well. So what you do first is you Google your software to print a paper wallet. For example, for Bitcoin, let me say Litecoin. You go to lightepress.org and you you download the software. You download the software of lightepress.org and really put it on your computer. And then you can say, okay, go offline and I'll run the software. And that's a really funny cryptographical trick that not many people know of. It's the fact that you can generate a virtual identity totally offline. Because there's so many options for public keys in the world, in the universe, that there's no chance that there's a collision with another public key. So that's what we ideally do. We run it offline, and we print it offline. Then we use the 3-2-1 rule. That means three copies on two different media and at least one different geolocation. So if you listen to that, it's more or less a 3-2-2 rule. But that's how they phrase it. So again, three copies, two media, and one other geolocation. And the last one is very important because many people lose value because they send the value of the cryptocurrency on a paper wallet partially to another wallet, and then you lose the other part of it. So you should transfer the full total amount from the paper wallet to the digital wallet. Anybody has questions about that?
Could you explain why that is?
I could explain it, but is it a good idea to explain it now? All right, okay. So, a Bitcoin transaction always uses a return address, a change address. And that's because a Bitcoin transaction has to be complete, valid in its own. So all parts of the sender to the receiver are specified, and the let's say the closing gap is the fee of the transaction. So we have a sending address, we have a receiving address, and we have another address that's a change address. On a paper wallet, there is no change address. So we lose the value if you would send it back. Is that all right for you? Okay, thank you. I think I left a few people with.
You can ask afterwards.
Yeah, ask us afterwards. You don't know how it works. So now again, the how. You want to know how. So I repeat the same sheet as before. But I think the most important message I got for you today is that you have to build up a routine. And I would suggest doing it. Introduce your key management afternoon, for example, and learn about all the aspects of key management security, like strong passwords, two-factor, secret sharing, lobby signing, etc. And learn about them and grow better every single step, and enjoy every single step. So I have got 1 minute left. And I promised in the invitation to talk about BIP 39 and BIP 44. These are Bitcoin and Root proposals. And BIP 39 is about this. It's C generation, easy to remember, because you want to have generated passwords and not self-invented passwords, because they're less secure. And there are many more advantages of BIP 39, especially the recovery of your password if you have written down one word the wrong way. There are several good things about this proposal. And the BIP 44 is one that a lot of people know because you can store multiple cryptos on a cold store. Putting Zcash in Bitcoin, Ethereum, BTC on the same ledger. And that's done by BIP 44. Any questions for now?
Yeah, I just want to add something that would be instructive. It's basically your C phrase is just about as valuable as it actually is. Because the C phrase is being so I put my Bitcoin in my treasure or put it away very safely. And then I put my C phrase behind painting in the living room or somewhere else. And that's something. If someone gets my C phrase, I'm equally screwed. So what I know is you split C phrase in two parts, 6 words or 12 words, and keep them in separate locations and make sure that nobody can get back to their own C phrase.
I will repeat your remark through the microphone, and then you can check what I got it wrong. He says that the seed phrase itself is very vulnerable to theft, for example. If you just store it like it is, somewhere in your house or somewhere else. And then you suggest to split it up, for example. And that might be it. We're not sure about advising people to do that, because we might become, people might go back to us and say, you said to me, you said to split it up. It's just, there's a few techniques to do it. You can also use the managed brain wallet to scramble a little bit up, you know. So there's several. You could use Shamir's secret sharing scheme, which is a very well-known way to split things up. 3 out of 5, 2 out of 3, 5 out of 7, to regenerate your seed. But we just decided not to go that far. But there are more techniques than just storing your plain seed.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Don't keep a seed phrase in one place, so, you know, your grandma or something.
Exactly, yeah. Okay. Thanks for that. Any other? Because I'm 3 minutes late.